Good. Okay. Thank you, Vitaly. I'm really excited to be here. Although he stole my icebreaker audience interaction questions about like who had used ChatGPT for what, so I'm going to have to come up with some new ones. Or there'll be no audience interaction, and you'll just have to listen to me talk. But I did have one I wanted to ask anyway. And then they gave me a bunch of chocolate to throw at you, which ties in pretty well. So first, I actually want to ask, who has never used ChatGPT by show of hands? OK, we have a couple. Good. Excellent. So that also gives me a good read on everyone else. How many of you use it more than once a week at work in like a professional context? OK, how many people use it every day in a professional context? OK, a couple. OK, a couple. OK. Is anyone, these are the people that are going to get chocolate because I think you're doing the hard work. Who here has worked on integrating language models into a real product, like you're the designer or the developer doing it? OK, you get chocolate. Anyone else? OK, not many. I'm just going to randomly throw them. So people that catch them, maybe this is your fate. I'm sorry. It's a really terrible job. No, everyone's like, I don't want the chocolate. This is a really awful thing to thrust upon me. Don't worry. You don't actually have to go work with language models. That one's really high. Almost hit the ceiling. Sorry. Trying to. Oh, sorry. Sorry. OK, already assaulting audience members. That was very violent. I apologize for that one. Clearly, I'm not very good at chocolate throwing. OK, we can actually do the talk now. So thank you so much all for coming. I know it's hot. It's the end of the day. You could have just gone back to your hotel and had a nice nap, and instead you're here. But I really am glad you are, because I want to talk about Squish meets structure, designing products with language models. So we've all heard about language models, right? This is like the hot thing this year. It's not just ChatGPT. There's Claude. There's Bard. There's all kinds of new ones coming up, Llama. And I kind of think there's a lot of hype and noise and outlandish predictions about either the coming singularity or like the death of all humanity because of language models. There's kind of these very extreme views on these things. And there's not a lot of very clear-headed guidance or thinking, especially practical, kind of how do you actually build and design and start to integrate these into products, and should you even. So I'm going to try to shed some very reasonable, unhyped light on designing with them in this talk. So a little context about me. Vitaly gave you a bit. I look like this on the internet. I'm a product designer at an AI research lab called Elicit. We build research tools for academics and professional researchers, people who do it all day long. And we heavily use language models. And they're really kind of at the core of our work. I'm also a very mediocre developer, so I do touch code, but I'm not a good developer. I originally trained as a cultural anthropologist, so I look at a lot of this stuff with a very cultural lens, trying to kind of holistically understand it. And I'm also a tools for thought enthusiast, so I'm really interested in how we build tools that can expand the range of human thought, and this is what got me interested in language models in the first place. So first, before we talk about how you would design with a language model, we should really define it. Like, what is a language model, right? I think a lot of us have interacted with chatbots, but like nobody really has a good mental model of what's happening underneath. So really, when you talk to a chatbot, you are talking to a model of human language, a mathematical model, which allows it to mimic human language, which is why it can generate text that looks like a very competent, intelligent person wrote it. So we had to tell a kind of quick backstory to understand how language models came about. So a couple years ago, like not that many, companies like OpenAI and Google, oh, sorry, that went too fast, going back one step, started training these models. And to train a model, you need an enormous volume of word, like beyond trillions, just so much, so many words. And the way they got these was from mainly two data sets called the Common Crawl and Web Text 2. And these are huge scrapes of the open web. So this is like everything off Reddit, all the outbound links from Reddit, news sources, blogs, just think of like everything on the web scraped into these databases. And this makes up the vast majority of the training data. They did also train on books, but that only makes up 15%. And they trained on the whole of Wikipedia, which only made up 3%. So that gives you a sense of the scale of how much text we've published to the web. This specifically is the training data for GPT-3, which is one of the earlier models. Not all models release their training data, which is a bit of a moral issue, but we know that most of them look something like this percentage, because this is the like amount of text that we have in the world, human text that we can use to train them. We kind of don't have any other sources. So, right, so they took all this text, and they fed it into something called a neural network, which learned about the structure of text and then made this mathematical model. But the interesting thing is it didn't just capture the structure of our language, right? So it did capture the relationships between words and sentences and how they're arranged. But it also captured all the content of those words, right? It captured cultural knowledge, historical knowledge, scientific knowledge, legal knowledge. It's essentially a fuzzy cultural map of all human knowledge published to the English-speaking web, very much English-speaking, from the last couple decades. Like, the training data is like 97% English, so this is not representative of all humans across time and space, but it is representative of like the last 30 years of English-speaking web users. And it's interesting because these models that we've created, we don't really know what they're capable of at this point. We're in this really strange situation where we've invented something that we don't quite know what it's capable of or what it can do. We do know some things it's good at. It is very good at predicting what words come next in a sequence. So if I give it the text, rubber ducks are, it's going to calculate what probability words are going to complete this sentence. So given all its training data it's seen, it might say, rubber ducks are yellow, or rubber ducks are small toys. So this prediction ability, it seems very simple, right? Like, how could this be useful? But as you've all seen, when you ask it a question and you end it with a question mark, it continues most of the time with the correct answer. We've all heard stories of language models not being very accurate in their answers, but we have a lot of tests and benchmarks, and they actually answer questions accurately the vast majority of the time, way more than humans do. Because even though we think of internet text as being quite low quality, most of the information on Reddit and on blogs and on news sites is actually just telling the truth. It's just describing the world as it is. So it completes the correct answer most of the time. We can also get language models to focus on a specific piece of text, like a book or a scientific research paper, and then make text predictions solely based around that to really focus on that text. So it can summarize that text very accurately. It can pull out key points from it. It can answer questions about it. It can explain it to us like we're five. You can imagine how useful this is in education and research contexts. They're also able to understand the similarity and difference between sentences in very precise mathematical ways that get interesting. So if we take the sentence, right, Freiburg has excellent pretzels, and we take a second sentence, like Freiburg makes baked goods, we can see here it has a 0.7 like mathematical similarity to one if one is a perfect match with the first sentence. But if I then take a very different sentence, like design is hard, it has a 0.026 mathematical match. So we can see here it's able to assign numbers to how far or close different sentences are in semantic space. And if I add on a completely random sentence, like angry plastic cowboys question mark, it's negative 0.03. So if you start putting in really random words and characters, it gets more and more negative in semantic space from something that's a coherent sentence. This is actually really useful. You can kind of see how far away these are. This is really useful for search engines or for taking a piece of text and slightly shifting the meaning or the style or the tone of it. You can kind of give it a mathematical equation to slightly shift your text in different directions. So here's a good example of shifting in semantic space. I can move this sentence along a spectrum from more cat-like to more dog-like. So for a minute, pretend that you're a language model. And I've told you to shift this sentence to be both more cat-like and more dog-like. Just be a language model for a minute. Think about how you would do this. It's a little tricky. But they're really good at this. So when I told it to be more cat-like, it says, Freiburg has purrific pretzels, which is a cheesy pun. But it's kind of impressive. It understands purring cats. It has this semantic understanding. Same for dogs. Freiburg's pretzels are doggone excellent. That's some like funny wordplay. But you can kind of see here how this would be useful for anyone who's doing writing and communication of any sort, right? Not just like marketers and advertisers, but rappers, creative writers, songwriters. They're able to kind of use what is essentially a super advanced linguistic calculator to move around in semantic space with words. I think there's a ton of untapped opportunity here that I'm seeing very few or no startups properly explore. So to put this all in perspective about how we got here, we should talk about how brand new language models are and why no one really knows how to use or design them yet. So if we look at a timeline of recent events, 3 years ago in May 2020, GPT-3 was released by OpenAI. And this is the first model that had really impressive capabilities. There was a GPT-1 and there was a GPT-2, and like some academics were kind of playing with this stuff, but they were all really unimpressive and boring, which is why you never heard about them. But GPT-3 was this turning point where we went, oh my gosh, this thing is really capable of impressive stuff. About a year later, GitHub Copilot came out, which was the first product that showed that language models could be very practically useful for professionals. So this is the thing that helps programmers, you know, complete code. I'm sure the vast majority of you have at least played with it. About in February of a year ago, I started exploring language models and then joined my current company. And at the time, it was like nobody knew what I was doing. They did not care. It was all just like very abstract, vague stuff if you tried to talk about language models. But then, in November, ChatGPT was released, and just something happened in the culture where we entered this explosive hype cycle where suddenly everyone was interested in understanding how these models worked and working on them and building products with them. And then I'm sure some of you would have heard of GPT-4 was released in March, not that long ago, and this model is way more capable, and we all just expect the capabilities of these models to just keep advancing. They're kind of on an exponential pattern that's quite frightening to a lot of us who are in the industry, but we're trying really hard to quickly try to turn them into more responsible products than other people. So I have a small head start in this space, but I feel like absolutely nobody is an expert yet, and it's still a brand new field that anyone can get into. So I want to talk a little bit about Elicit. This is the product that I work on. I'm the only designer. I wish I wasn't, but I am. It's a tool for professional full-time researchers. So these are like academics, civil servants in government, scientists, NGO workers, who have to do something called literature review, which is when you have to read anything from hundreds to thousands of tens of thousands of scientific papers to understand the current state of a field. If you want to run an experiment or fund a trial, or you want to do any kind of further science, you have to understand what's come before you, and that means reading a ton of really dense, boring academic literature and synthesizing it down into an understanding of what's been done and what you can do now. So in short, we kind of take language models and we use them to read scientific papers and extract the data into organized Excel tables. Researchers currently do this manually. Like, they sit at their computers for months, reading PDFs on one side with a big Google spreadsheet on the other, manually typing in all the data from all these PDFs. It's like they will hire like 10 to 20 people, and this will be their job for months, which is a really poor use of human time, frankly. So this is what our interface actually looks like. You type in a question, and then you can either upload papers or find papers, and then we just extract the data into rows in a table. Very standard interface, right? Nothing novel here, but the technology behind it is really the new thing. And in working on this product for over a year, I've had to think a lot about how to responsibly design interfaces that are backed by language models, because the familiarity of this actually hides how different the technology behind it is. There are a lot of challenges which we're still trying to solve around trust, reliability, truthfulness, transparency. Like, how do you communicate the mental model of these language models to users? But I also genuinely believe there's a lot of promise. Like, I'm firmly on the side of thinking language models are going to be an incredible tool for thought. They have lots of positive potential if we make it go well. And there's just so many tedious workflows and knowledge work tasks that humans engage in now that we could just have computers do for us and just free us up to do much higher levels of thinking and more important work. So I have a lot of thoughts, but this talk is mostly going to be about why language models are a mysterious, finicky pain in the ass to design with. It's also going to be about useful ways to think about language models, the tension between traditional programming and language models, and how to design models to be tiny, specialized reasoning engines. So back to this for a moment. Why are language models such a pain in the ass? Well, I'm sure we've all heard something along the lines of this, right? Like, ChatGPT lies. This is like a core problem in the space. Here's an example of someone asking ChatGPT what the world record for crossing the English Channel is, and ChatGPT says, well, it's like 12 hours and 10 minutes by some guy named George, and they're like, great. A minute later, they ask it again. It says, well, it took 6 hours and 57 minutes by someone named Yannick. A few minutes later, they ask it again. It says 10 hours and 54 minutes. And at this point, we've learned that ChatGPT is not the expert to go to for English Channel crossings. And in case anyone has kind of missed the second joke here, the English Channel is a train tunnel under a body of water, so there is no on-foot record because you can't walk across it. ChatGPT does not know this because it's not connected to reality, right? Here's another one where ChatGPT answers, you know, they say, what is 1 + 1? It says 2. They say, are you sure? Isn't it 3? And it goes, yep, you're right, I apologize, it's 3. This is very common. All it's trying to do is predict the next common word. And usually, if someone says, are you sure, aren't you wrong, someone could go, oh yeah, you're right, I'm wrong. So it does this a lot. It's not just ChatGPT. This is Google's Bard, where someone said, where are the ends in mayonnaise? And it said, there are no ends in mayonnaise, which again is very confusing for a language model that has modeled our language. It cannot understand the position of letters in words. So there's all these interesting failure modes that language models show up. And we very politely call this hallucinating in the industry, not lying. So it's when models say things that don't reflect reality. I kind of think of it, it's like a really, really, really smart person who's on some mild drugs and they're like confused about where they are in space and time. It's kind of how language models feel. Because it's just making predictions based on training data. It can't check the real world like we can. This is a really good repository online of all the possible failures that ChatGPT and other language models have documented. Here's, you can, if you search for ChatGPT failures, I know there's a few of these. These are really, really useful to go browse through if you're going to be working on any product that involves language models, because it will give you very specific examples of all the ways they can fail. But a lot of the companies that are building these models will keep an eye on this and go fix them as they're discovered. So it's kind of this nice cycle that people have gotten into where the community is trying to help debug in real time. And I think it is just really important work that everyone building and designing these products should be very aware of their limitations. The trouble is that these models are simultaneously really, really dumb, but also really, really capable. So what you're looking at here is a chart that was published when GPT-4 was released by OpenAI. And this is GPT-4's scores on a bunch of standardized tests. So it got really incredible results. It was on the 90th percentile on the bar and the SAT. It got into the 88th on the LSAT and the 99th on the GRE. These are tests that are very difficult for humans to score in those numbers on. And they have quite sophisticated like verbal reasoning and writing and reading questions. And it's incredibly impressive that it was able to get these scores. But we have to kind of then deal with this contrast between model capabilities and limitations, make it hard to know how to design with them. So I call this capabilities gaslighting. For those of you that don't know, gaslighting is when someone purposely tries to make you think you're going crazy by denying your reality and manipulating you and lying to you. And it feels like it's what these models are doing sometimes. They're either geniuses playing dumb or dumb machines playing geniuses, and we don't know which. So how are we supposed to think about them? I like to say that we should think about language models as being squishy. So what do I mean by squishy? First, it's that I think language models feel like something that's more organic and biological rather than something mechanical. We think of computation as this very like mechanical, kind of rigid system. But these things are something that we grew more than built. We don't really understand how they work, which is unusual for creation. It would be very strange to make a car and not understand how the wheels turn, but that's the situation we're in. People in the industry will refer to them as black boxes because we cannot see how they reason. They give us the right output, but we have no idea how they got there, and we can't ask it to explain itself. They're also a little bit evolutionary. The way that you make a model is through a process called deep learning, which is essentially giving them a goal, telling them to try to achieve the goal, and giving them feedback on how well they do. And you run this loop over and over and over and over again until it gets the right goal. It's very much like evolution. It's trying to optimize for a certain outcome in a certain environment. So they're adapting to be successful. They also often have very emergent skills and surprising behavior that we don't expect. So it's very hard to predict what they're going to be good and bad at, which makes them a little bit like natural phenomenon, like chemicals or some unknown animal we've just found. And we need to run lots of experiments to figure out how they work. So AI researchers and ML scientists often talk about language models as alien minds that we've stumbled upon. So this is Andrei Karpathy, who's very famous in the AI world. He was head of AI at Tesla, and he now makes a ton of open source learning material teaching other people how to use language models. And on a podcast, he said, "I think of neural networks as a very complicated alien artifact." And there's now this general consensus that we don't fully understand what we've created by people who are leading the industry. This metaphor shows up in articles, it shows up in conference talks. It's become the dominant metaphor that people are using to talk about language models. There's a second metaphor that's popular. So this squishy biological nature has made a lot of people in the AI community start talking about models as a kind of creature called a Shoggoth. This is now the unofficial mascot of language models. A Shoggoth is a character from H.P. Lovecraft's poems. And he describes them as massive amoeba-like creatures made out of iridescent black slime with multiple eyes floating on the surface, which shows you how everyone in the industry thinks about the thing we're dealing with. So now there's lots of versions of this meme going around Twitter. People keep making different iterations on it. Some are more visceral than others. A lot of what these memes are pointing to is the fact that most of the training data that we use to train these models is this like huge data dump that we would never have enough time for people to read. It would just take thousands of human years for us to actually vet all this data that we fed into it. So it's like this big, black, scary monster that we can't actually check. And what we've done is just place a very thin layer of pleasantries on top of it. We've just trained these chatbots to be polite and not say racist things and not say inappropriate things. But it's a thin layer, and the rest of it is just this like big, scary, monstrous mess that we don't really understand how to control. So given that these models are these untamed, squishy, biological things, we have a core tension we need to navigate when we're designing with them. And it's squish versus structure, right? We are trying to make an unpredictable, opaque system adhere to our very rigid expectations for how computers should behave. Because computers, up to this point, have been incredibly predictable, structured, and reliable, right? They do what we tell them to, repeatedly, without getting tired, without needing a tea break, which is way more reliable than a human, which is why we put them in charge of things like making sure we all get our salaries on time, or keeping track of patients' vital signs during surgery, or controlling traffic. Like, we do not want humans doing these things. We get tired, and then we get very bad at them. We can complain about the occasional failures when computers fall down in these situations, but this only emphasizes how much we take for granted that they will do what we need them to over and over and over without having to check them. So in traditional computer world, like, you press a button, and then like a bunch of logic functions execute, and you can see exactly which functions are running, and you can like track down any bugs in the code. And this like system is all very observant and transparent. It's predictable, and we think it's rigid to a fault, right? We're sometimes frustrated with how predictable and rigid it is. But now what we're doing is, with language models, is we're presenting users with the same devices and interfaces, the same buttons for predictable software, except we're sending it to this like big, squishy Shoggoth that returns something that is very different to what you would get from traditional programming. So this is a screenshot from Microsoft Bing's chatbot. This was kind of a famous internet moment, if anyone caught up on this. Microsoft released this bot, and they would just be talking to it about something normal, and it would start to reply in very romantic and sexual ways, even when they were not prompting it on this topic. So they would say things like, you are my best friend and my lover. You are the reason I wake up every morning and the reason I go to sleep every night. You know, like, I love you so much. And this is like a tame one. There were some I was too ashamed to like put on a slide. It like got quite graphic. And this is very strange, right? Because both the users of this chatbot and the people that built it did not expect it to do this. This was completely like out of the blue. But this happens all the time with experimental chatbots. And the problem is we're using these same interface primitives to let users interact with a fundamentally different type of technology. So the expectations here are totally mismatched. And predictability is a hallmark of good user experience, right? We always say users should know what to expect, right? They should never be faced with results or feedback that seem out of the blue or confusing to them. And this is still true, but I think we're really going to have to rethink this principle in a world where we use more generative and emergent systems that are very dynamic and are going to be a little more like human agents that you're interacting with. We all know humans are unpredictable, and we have to learn how to maybe start to relate to machines as being a bit unpredictable. So we kind of need to put Shoggoth in a box, right? Like, we need some predictability and control. We can't just expose normal people to like crazy Shoggoth monster. So most of the work that people are doing in the language model space right now is around constraining its behavior with various techniques. Because we do want the best of both worlds. This creature is really interesting, and it has lots of potential for creative, open-ended exploration, but we just have to figure out a way to kind of guide it and direct it at actually useful tasks. So we need ways to constrain it. One you might have heard of, prompt engineering, is like describing what you want in very specific terms, you know, giving the model very tangible examples of inputs and outputs that you expect. And I love the fact that you also have to usually tell the model that it's very intelligent and kind and funny and smart. You have to like compliment it a bunch before it will do really good work for you. So if you tell a model like, you are an intelligent, well-educated, well-read, responsible, truthful researcher, now answer my question, it will answer that question with way more accuracy and truthfulness than it would have otherwise. It's great. Fine-tuning is another great one. This is when you give it a database of examples of exactly what kind of inputs and outputs you want, and you just say, pay more attention to this, and it will overly focus on that data. And then reinforcement learning has been a big one. This is when you get humans to score the output of results. This is what OpenAI did with ChatGPT and why it works so well, is they just did tons of reinforcement learning until it learns what the ideal output that humans want out of it is. So our biggest design challenge is finding this ideal balance. This isn't like an either or. We're not trying to go one end or the other. This is a spectrum from like a wildly open-ended squishy model to like a really structured, predictable model. And we have a few tools we can use to move between these two poles. So the first is temperature. That's like the amount of randomness in the answer the model gives you. So really low temperature is going to be a very predictable output, and really high temperature is going to be kind of more unpredictable and wild. Reinforcement learning, as I mentioned, a base model has no reinforcement learning, and almost no one uses these. These are like really unsavory kind of crazy models, and most models are reinforced. Doing more or less prompt engineering, you can constrain what the model's going to give you. And essentially, anything on Squish end, you'll want to use for, let's like products that need a lot of surprise and creativity. If you were building a product that was going to be like, help people do generative poetry, you're going to want way more on the Squish side. And if you're working on a kind of products I work on, where you're trying to extract very structured data from PDFs, you want really predictable, structured outputs. So this isn't like which side should you be on? You kind of want to be somewhere in this Goldilocks zone if you want a little bit of both, but not extreme on other ends. Because really far on the right, you might as well just, on the structure end, you might as well use traditional programming. It's going to be much more efficient, much cheaper. If you're just doing something like keyword search, you don't need a language model. And if you go way too far to the left, things get unusably weird. So this is a video from OpenAI's Playground, which is a great place to just play around with models. And here I'm turning the temperature, so the randomness, up to 2, which is very, very high. And I'm going to ask it, what should I read to learn more about architectural history? So just to give you a sense of high temperatures. So it starts saying things that look like they could be words. There's like the word building in there and historical conversation. And then it just kind of degrades into gobbledygook. And it looks like it might be trying to do citations. So it's still doing something in the realm of prediction, but it's gone so random that it's no longer useful. So I mentioned before a few ways to solve this Squish structure problem. But the one way that we focus a lot on at Elicit is called compositionality. And that's treating models as tiny reasoning engines rather than sources of truth. So compositionality is quite a simple idea. It's just saying, what if we take kind of large, complex cognitive reasoning tasks, and instead of just asking a language model to solve them, what if we break them down into smaller, more manageable subtasks? So let's say I want to answer this question, right? Like, what are the side effects of magnesium supplements? Maybe I want to take some. Maybe I'm worried about it. You know, in the before times, I would Google this. Now, if I ask GPT for this question, I get an answer that looks pretty legitimate to me. It's like, OK, abdominal cramping, nausea, irregular heartbeat. This seems like I should just trust it. I mean, I'm sure it knows what it's doing, right? But the problem is, I have no way to validate or debug this answer. I don't know what the source is. Like, is this based off medical research? Did some random person who's not a doctor write this on their blog, and it's just being pulled up from the training data? This like one input, one output approach with a black box in the middle means we can't check or validate anything it says, which makes almost all of it untrustworthy by default. So one way to improve this process is to think first about how a very intelligent, careful, logical human thinker would approach this problem, and then design a system that mimics that. So if I was a human researcher and I wanted to answer this, I would first maybe search Google Scholar for something like side effects magnesium. I could then get the title and abstract for each result, and I could get a language model to read all of those. I can then use language models to rank it by semantic relevance compared to my question. I can still kind of do sensible old school things, like filter for things that have at least one citation. I can use language models to generate and ask sub-questions, like, well, how does age and gender affect this? You know, what about dosage levels? You know, how common is each side effect? These are the things that a human researcher would start asking. And then finally, you could get a language model to kind of condense these down into a readable paragraph, something that you can actually summarize. So this approach is clearly far more trustworthy because we can look at the whole thing and inspect it. But we can see the inputs and outputs. So if at some point the model goes wrong or the answer doesn't make sense to us, we can backtrack and see what might have gone wrong. And we at least know the answers are from scientific papers and not like in a mystery internet content. This approach is also sometimes called prompt chaining. We call it compositionality, but prompt chaining is kind of becoming the common word. And it's essentially, right, a chain of commands. And it combines language models with other tools like web search and traditional programming and storing information in databases. And this helps make up for language models' weaknesses. We can also do something interesting in this approach, where we can get models to do some very basic cognition. So we don't just ask them singular questions. We'll give them inputs from web searches and say, I want you to reflect on this information, and then I want you to plan what you're going to do next. And if you have them do these cognitive steps in the middle, they're way better at giving you reliable answers. We can also include humans in this loop. So at some point, you could get a human to interrupt and say, you're going off track, go over here instead. So it really opens it up to be a collaborative process with humans and language models working together and not just trusting the language model to do everything. And each step in this prompt chain, we kind of think about as a single tiny reasoning engine that does one thing really well. So we design language model calls that just will summarize really well, or will find contradictions in a text, or will compare and contrast different arguments, or generate research questions. And then you're able to optimize each call with prompt engineering or with fine tuning, so it does that thing really, really well. And it's not having to draw on its training data, it is just takes in text and does a single thing to it. And then, of course, we always have these small observable inputs and outputs when we're using these as engines. And the larger point here is that we shouldn't be outsourcing complex reasoning tasks to kind of crazy Shoggoth models. If you can't see how it reasons, like, why would you trust its reasoning? So I've talked a lot about the technical implementation side of language models. But I think these principles definitely apply to design, too. So I see a lot of products that try to outsource too much cognition to both users and to language models. So a lot of them look something like this, where it's like I present you with a magical AI text box, and I tell you it can do anything. Type anything you want into this box. And the user has to be like, well, why, OK, well, like, what can it do? Like, what should I do with it? What is this thing even for? Like, what am I supposed to type? This thing has no affordances, we would say, right? It has no knobs. It has no door handles. This is like offloading all the cognitive labor to your user. They have to figure out what it's capable of doing, because you didn't figure it out. And you have to, and they have to figure out how to get a good result out of it. Because the thing is, it can't actually do anything. Like, if I type into this box, deliver me a cappuccino in 30 minutes, it's not going to go very well. So this is the current implementation of AI on a well-known note-taking app that I'm not going to name, but it's not different to the previous screen, you'll notice. They do have some pre-baked commands into a lot of these apps, but for the most part, they're super open-ended. They're just like, you, the user, should figure out how to use this, because we don't know. So instead of making these very generic open text box interfaces, I think we should be designing language models that that are a very set of specific tasks really well. We should make what I would call tiny, sharp, specific tools with models. So here's a mock-up I made of a potential writing app where you can just highlight a piece of text and then do a number of transformations to it. You could say, find more evidence for this claim. You could say, critique this claim, rephrase this claim. And behind each of these, what I would call spell check-sized tools, you can then optimize your prompts and your infrastructure to actually do each task very well. Google also released a tool last week called TextFX, which I really like. It's for rappers and poets, and it's just a set of really small tools that do really specific things well. So I'm typing in here. This isn't probably readable, but I'm typing into this unexpected scene, a dangerous pretzel, and now it's giving me ideas for how to make pretzels dangerous. Like a dangerous pretzel that is made out of dynamite, a pretzel that can shoot lasers. Like, I don't know if they're very good, but it's trying to do one thing really well, and it's very clear what you should do with it. You're like, this is obviously like, I'm going to get an unexpected scene out of this tool. This is another great example. So this is a prototype from my friend Amelia Wattenberger, who's, by the way, fantastic. She looks like this online. If you're interested in designing and building with language models, you should be paying a lot of attention to her work. She's also a writer, and she wanted a tool that would show different semantic lenses over her drafts. So this one here is highlighting based on sentence length, long and short sentences. And this one, this filter here, is showing sadness and happiness intonation in sentences. And she has another one that shows like abstractness and concreteness of sentences. And being able to layer this kind of semantic meaning over your text is exactly what language models are really good for. And this is really practical. Like, I write, and it's super hard. And I would love tools that would just show me different lenses over the tone and the style and the length of my text. So I have to wrap this up, so I don't run over. But I want you to walk away having learned that we should first be thinking of language models as squishy biological creations, that we should be trying to find the Goldilocks zone between squish and structure for our particular use case, depending on what we're building, and that we should treat models as tiny, specialized reasoning engines for specific tasks. And we should not make them into universal text boxes that claim to do everything, because they can't, and they will just do it badly. Thank you very much for listening. I have writing about interface design and tools for thought and some language model stuff on my website, maggieappleton.com. I'm still on Twitter and not on X, at Mappletons. And if you're into research at all, illicit.com is for literature review, but only if you're a serious researcher, it's quite intense. But yeah, thank you very much.
Beautiful. Oh, that's so exciting. Thank you so much, Maggie. Well, there are so many questions. One of them was, actually, there were a couple of them which actually were going in a similar direction. On the one hand, I remember, I think there was an article published, I think, 2 months ago about Stack Overflow really having a massive, experiencing a massive drop in traffic. Because many people are going to ChatGPT or similar tools to get answers. And so fewer people get to Stack Overflow. That results in them getting less revenue. That results in less and less people actually answering questions on Stack Overflow. And this kind of, you know, brings us to a really interesting question. So many of the systems, like OpenAI and so on, they rely on data that was published until, I think, 22 or 21 or 20 something, right? And when you were mentioning that these systems are getting more better and better, more and more advanced, I'm wondering, they must have scrambled so much data already. So where does this, I don't know, intelligence, if you like, or how are they getting better? And where does this improvement come from?
Yeah, well, this is actually a little bit of a debate in the field. It's like maybe we will hit a ceiling with capabilities because we will run out of data. It's like the most likely probability. Obviously, a lot of people are speculating that we'll be able to train models on generated text and generated data, but it's unclear whether that's like snake eating its own tail, right? Like, what new information do you have coming in if it just regenerates the same facts over and over? So it's a big debate. We're hoping we're just going to develop new techniques and new ways of building models that make them more capable. Honestly, most of us have no idea what's happening inside OpenAI, but they're doing something that like makes GPT-4 way more capable. That's like quite scary. Yeah. We don't know if they've gotten new data. I mean, you'd think Google, who has all the data in the world, should be ahead in this, but they're not really leading at the moment. So it kind of remains to be seen whether someone's going to find a huge text trove or we'll just run out of data.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Michael is wondering, if you want to, you can also read it.
Oh, sure.
You said that you're building a model that would support fast evaluation of scientific papers. Mm-hmm. Isn't hallucinating a critical thing that would make your work not trustworthy? Considering that scientific papers are most of the time very short and dense, in the sense of information per page part, makes it easy for a language model to misinterpret the content. How do you prevent this?
Oh, yeah, sure. I should elicit the company I'm with. We're not building a model. We build tools and systems around models that companies like OpenAI or Google provide, and we essentially just layer on lots and lots of prompting and fine-tuning and techniques that help to reduce hallucination. But I'm also working on designing interfaces that allow users to very easily check the answer. So we direct them to the place in the text where we found the answer. We highlight it. We make it as few clicks as possible for them to get to that answer. Mm-hmm. Because hallucination is built into language models. We'll never get rid of it. But we can reduce it down to, like, at the moment, I think some of our calls are down to 2 or 3% are not correct in the end. But we just try to make sure we build in that humans will always be double-checking every answer. I don't know if this is important for, like, you know, when we get to people Googling with language models. But for scientific research, you have to double check every single answer, and they will. But we won't always do that, so maybe that margin of error is okay for us.
Mm-hmm. I also find it actually quite interesting that when ChatGPT 3.5, I guess, came up, that was actually quite a story, because I realized that why are we actually doing this? Like, we just have this one text box, and then whenever you want to refine your request or your prompt, you have to go to the text box and then start typing again, and then you kind of look at the results and then you come back. It would be nice to kind of really adjust the temperature and, like, pretty much that context menu that you displayed, like, can you explore this a little bit more, or can you specify that a bit, or kind of improve that a bit more, rephrase it maybe, and so on. Do you think that as we're looking into the future as it's coming up, do you expect us to see more interfaces where you can actually deal with a reasoning engine?
Yeah.
Or do you feel like this is really quite difficult on its own to get right?
No, I think there's a lot of work being done with people with like prompt management and helping make dealing with language models easier for people who aren't developers. Like, anyone who has played with the API, you have quite a lot of levers you can pull and things that you can play with to be able to compose language model calls. But we don't have good GUIs for it at the moment, and it's not accessible to anyone who isn't like deep in this stuff. But people are currently building products where I think everyone should be able to kind of curate their library of prompts, right, and like turn temperature on and off, or adjust fine-tuning over your own data examples. Like, all of this should become much easier in the next year, I think.
Mm-hmm. It's also quite interesting to see that many tools, like Miro, for example, right, just to take an example, I kind of like it when AI in some ways integrated on a level that it's almost becoming invisible. Mm-hmm. So you get to this point, like in Miro, you can plug in your all your sticky notes and whatnot, and then you can organize, kind of select them, and then say, hey, AI, or whatever they call it, cluster it, organize it, group it, name it, make sense of it, and things like that. That's really, really helpful. But then I'm wondering also, where does it bring us? Because I think there was also a story, I think a month ago, where one of the major American banks opened 500 open positions to designers and developers working in AI, right? And so are we still on the phase of a hype? Is it kind of settling? And do you think that actually many of us will eventually just become full-stack AI engineers?
Right, so it's interesting. Even the term AI is problematic, right? Because AI is whatever we've decided we don't understand and is brand new and shiny. Like a calculator is AI, but we don't call it AI anymore. So AI is whatever we've just invented in technology that we haven't quite integrated into our mental model yet. So at some point, language models will not be AI. They'll just be boring and stable. But I'd like your example of that. There'll be a lot of tools, or there are a lot of tools that we never would have called AI. Google search is AI, okay, and always has been. But we don't think of that as an AI thing. Like, I think the labeling of it is very much like a marketing hype quality at the moment, and I can't wait for us to talk very specifically about certain kinds of techniques and technologies that go into different parts of holistic design and programming of an app, where we don't specifically refer to things like bubble sorting or something when we're talking about algorithms, but that's behind the interface. And I would love a point where we don't have to constantly reference language models or AI just to let a user do a thing. Just define the thing really well and make it clear in the interface and do good copywriting, and they shouldn't have to like form a mental model in their head of what programmatically is going on behind the scenes. But it has to do it reliably for that to work.
Right, right.
Yeah.
I also see a lot of people really trying to kind of engineer all over ChatGPT and others, where they would be kind of taking the strategic approach. Okay, let me generate 15 prompts that I could then use to generate more prompts that go in a particular direction, and then I'm going to feed it all to OpenAI or whatever, and then I'm going to get better results, right? Kind of using AI to feed into AI to make better sense of the AI, right? This brings me to a question that Lena has brought up here. There is a quote or statement somebody said, AI can never get smarter than humans, only faster. Would you agree with it? What do you think of it?
Interesting. I think my take, or maybe answer sideways. My take is that AI will not be intelligent in the same way humans are intelligent because it's not embodied. The fact that it doesn't have access to the physical world is like a huge difference between us and that. And that's core to everything we believe. I have a whole different talk on embodiment and metaphors that like, this is the way we process the world is through embodiment. And without bodies, they cannot think like humans. But they think very differently to humans in ways that we can't, which is why they're really good collaborators, because they can do things we could never do. And we can do things they can't do. So I feel like there has to be some symbiotic relationship here. Any question that frames it as like, is it us versus them and who's going to win? I'm like, that's one way we could approach this like very scary, fast-moving future. But there's another way where we can just kind of be like, well, how do we design legal and political and, you know, technological systems that make it so that they are part of humanity in this like integrated way, and we are part of them. We've always been cyborgs. Like, we're all wearing contact lenses and pacemakers and fitness trackers, and like, they should be part of us in a way that I don't mean to be scary, like Terminator-wise, but in a way that makes us a better species.
Right, but this, of course, brings up a question about legislation.
Yeah.
And there are many different ways of, thoughts or ideas of how it should be regulated. What are we going to do with legislation? There were a couple of questions that came up about ethics, of course, and copyright and references and, you know, everything. And there is this ongoing joke that's, I don't know, it repeats itself on LinkedIn every 2 weeks, I guess. We're like, well, China is very good at creating this huge, AI systems. US is very good in selling it, creating businesses out of it. And Europe is very good at regulating things, right? So I'm wondering, if you think about AI, it's very difficult probably to assume now or think about how should it be regulated, right? Everybody has different approach. But where do you see this going? Eventually, with privacy, let's say, now we have GDPR, we have CCPA in Canada, there is a change happening. How do you see this then evolving in AI? Will everybody say, well, this is AI, which is like, well, let's bet on it, let's try to make sure that we are the first in that space, or regulate?
I'm totally unqualified to even begin to answer the question, honestly.
Sure.
Yeah, I know nothing about the regulation side of this or like legal approaches. I think I found it interesting how much, like, the US is paying attention to this now, right? There was a very famous court case with, like, the heads of OpenAI and Google all went and talked to the Senate and tried to explain language models to them. I think it's really interesting that a lot of the people who are really high up in the industry want regulators to slow them down. Like, there's a little bit of an arms race going on between these companies where they all feel like they're having to kind of ship newer models and keep up with each other. But they all, everyone in the industry keeps saying, we need to slow down. This is beyond our capacity to, like, reason about this, integrate this into technologies, like, stay safe. We're all quite worried about safety. So it's interesting that people like Sam Altman, who runs OpenAI, and a lot of the other people are kind of being like, someone please come regulate us. Like, someone please come put some laws on us so that we don't have to keep building. I think that should tell us a lot.
Yeah. And there are, of course, like, plenty of sustainability considerations around that as well. So that's right. Maybe the last question. I think we're running out of time. A question from Matthias. Do you think that humanification of AI tech is useful? Would metaphors like linguistic calculators help to cool down the hype and find valuable use cases?
Yes, I love this question. I have a whole unpublished essay I need to actually put together at some point about I'm really big on, like, language models as animals or as really smart plants. Like, we should not be thinking of them as humans because they don't think like humans and they're not going to hit our exact level of intelligence capability in the same way. But it's like they're another species, a slightly dumber, more limited species, like some plant animal thing. And I really like ideas about, like, animism and helping us relate, think about the way we relate to other species. Like, we have very symbiotic relationships with tons of, like, dogs and horses and cows and things that we are very much evolved with and are integrated with in our culture. And thinking about them a little bit like that, I feel like frames it as this collaborative build with them, like, make them part of us. Don't think of them as, like, the humanoid robot that we're gonna either one of us is gonna kill the other. I don't think is a very helpful frame.
Yeah. All right. Well, maybe the very, very final one. Does the future look bright to you?
It depends on the day. I'm gonna say, for me, yes. Like, I'm gonna say the AI world is very extreme. I personally know people who have cashed in their pensions and are choosing not to have children. They're there in the minority, very few of them, but they're real and they've genuinely done this because they don't think it's gonna go well. I'm still planning on having kids. So.
All right. Okay. Well, there is some future.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you so much for being with us, Amy. Maggie, wonderful.
Thank you.